pin will be LeBlanc, followed by Lulu, Irelia, and Sojani.
And now that Irelia is a big takeaway from RMU, Zig has played Irelia in quite a number of the playoff games and actually just dominated through University of Michigan, I believe it was, in one of the final games over in their region. So not too much of a surprise to see that banned away.
Yeah, that will not be any surprise at all. The Kalista comes through as well. It's in the NALCS, it's a big takeaway. Morgana as well will be the final ban from RMU, and a very first fast pickup of Gragas, which we saw in the first best of three as well.
Yeah, saw it in both games of the best of three. Obviously a flex pick, but it is showing some kind of solidarity between our first series and our second of the day.
Yeah, the next two pickups will be Hecarim and Urgot again. We saw the Urgot earlier, but no Hecarim.
So if you're a good Irelia player, what else could you potentially like to see up in that top lane? Hecarim. Hecarim is pretty much the meta carry top laner right now. So not too much of a surprise to see Zig pick that up. Also, kind of following on from a lot of what we've seen in NA, that Urgot we've seen a lot in Korea as well. Very high priority onto that here for RMU as well.
Yeah, UConn, they're wasting no time with their picks to come out with the Sivir and Cho'Gath, already looking for the run at UConn position.
Yeah, and now Cho'Gath is actually a bit of a takeaway from RMU here. RMU played Cho'Gath in a couple of their finals games as well, the very same games they were running Irelia, so not too surprising to see UConn take them away. They've got a very clear strategy in this game.
Yeah, they've played that one before, and it will be Rek'Sai locked in, looking for their support as well. Really just going through these picks and bans so quickly, and that has been locked in as well. There comes the Fresh, now looking for the Bard. However, I'd love to see a Bard.
I would, but over on the RMU side, there's a whole lot of pressure in the early game and catch potential and engage potential from this RMU squad. They've got a little bit of everything so far. Rek'Sai early game jungling, Thresh for the catch, Hecarim for the engages and the flanks from the side, and Urgot is that big tank AD carry right now. So, you know, there's a lot on RMU's plate here that are pretty meta picks that everybody is saying are, you know, creeping up towards that top tier.
Yeah, it's the pick and mix composition coming through from RMU right now. UConn, what will they pick? They're hovering over the Gnar and they lock it in, so they will go for that laning phase up against Hecarim. It means he has that strong lane up against him. Whether that transitions into mid-game, late-game, that's a question that Bridge will have to come to later. And they do lock in the Alistar as well.
And now, with final lock-in of Orianna to round out the composition, RMU have got a fair amount of scaling here when it comes to a lot of their damage and engage potential. Orianna, of course, is going to become a very prominent throughout. You can get that ball onto the Hecarim, onto the Rek'Sai, get her in and start a fight. Over on the other side, I kind of want to pick up on that Gnar that got locked in. Gnar, as you said, better in the laning against Hecarim. He has slightly less consistent engages, and by slightly, I mean if you're not in Mega Gnar, you're not engaging.
Yeah, so, and that's hard nowadays with the Gnar bar being changed, yeah.
It is, but over on UConn's side, look at how tanky they can end up being. Alistar, Cho'Gath, Gragas that's going to build Cinderhulk, Gnar up in that top lane as well while in Mega Gnar, and a Sivir on top of that to engage. That's a lot of engage potential here on UConn's squad, team composition here. RMU and UConn kind of just want to fight.
Yeah, they want to fight, and they want to fight early, because that's a difficult composition to get through from UConn. As soon as they start scaling up, as soon as they get some tank items, how are you going to get through that with an Urgot, with a Hecarim? You just simply will not have the damage the later and later it goes. But if they engage on top of them early while they're still squishy, gonna have a good time.
Yeah, it's gonna be a very explosive game from these team comps by the looks of it. And after our last series, we had pentakills, almost pentakills. I mean, there's everything. Yeah, pentakill steals. Oh man, that's the moment where you
take off your headset
and you
walk out.
Yeah, exactly. But you know, we had a lot in the first series of the day. Let's see what our second brings for us.
Well, here we go, ladies and gentlemen, getting into game for our second best of three today in the semifinals here at the NACC with RMU up against UConn, bringing it to the Rift.
We are onto the Rift, as you said. Now, you know, there's a lot of school and college and university pride here in America. I'm feeling it already from everybody. It's very much so an awesome feeling. Very different feeling, actually, from events that we normally cast, but very much so a community awesome feel here.
Yes, indeed. I'm hearing that from the crowd as well. Yeah. Super hyped right now in this audience. And let's see how this all pans out. Stress. Zig now heading into the bottom lane. So they may go for a potential lane swap, or just trying to go for a death bush, and may go for that level one strat, put three people in that bottom brush. But right now, with the Fresh in the top lane, what are RMU looking for?
That's a big question. It's something that UConn are going to have tried to figure out, because RMU, as everybody kind of knows, our analysts talked about, they've got this massive wealth of support staff behind them, where they've got numerous coaches, people that have been in the scene for a very long time. So you expect them to come into a game as important as this and have their level one planned meticulously. So it's no surprise that we're seeing something a tad different out of RMU when it comes to not looking for standard lanes. But if there's one team that I'm kind of expecting to look to maybe lane swap, RMU would be the one.
Yeah, they have so many coaches, they could make another team and still have a coach. meanwhile, on the UConn side, what are they looking for the early game? They have a long way to go if they want to take down the favorites and the champions of this tournament, but they can do it. They still have the chance.
Kind of interesting at this point. One thing that we kind of normally see Hecarim doing from time to time is you actually just start with a flask, and you leave yourself a versatile start to scout out where your enemies are. Neither team really opted for deep wards yet. You can see Mini Bestia now, they kind of have assumed that UConn are trying to start on the Grump, so a good read here. And now this allowed Hecarim here to just start with pots and get to lane faster than if he had to go all the way back and buy. We'll see if he ends up using his teleport.
Yeah, that was super good by Mini Bestia. He stopped them from taking that initial camp, and now Jasmine will be going on to that secondary one just further away from the Fresh. So we have gone for the lane swap. Zig as well will be going with the buddy system with Oberyn as well.
Okay. So that is indeed what they're going to look to do with that buddy system. You saw at the same time up in the top lane, Tails actually pulled the wave, made sure it was freezing up in the top side. So this is a very well thought out opening to RMU. I'm interested to see how UConn are going to react to that, as Sivir and Alistar, they took the Krugs, and now they are down in that bottom lane.
Yeah, they have balanced the wave as well, so it's all about how they react to this lane swap from RMU, because that can really take a team off guard if they're not used to playing into a game where RMU are already dictating the pace of the game from minute one.
And this is a very different game to our first series of the day. This is much more meticulous, more planned out than we've saw in game one, where by this point we'd already had first blood in our very first game of the day. So this is really UConn. They're going to have to play the game of strategy here and try and outmind game RMU a little bit. Make sure they're making the right calls at the right times. Oberyn going to go get that topside crab and make sure that Urgot can sit there on his own and make sure he's completely safe in that topside.
Well, the mid lane we haven't spoken about yet. Mr. F has changed his name here up against a Leo. It will be Orianna versus Cho'Gath matchup, so there's going to be a lot of farming, I have to feel, Mr. Stress.
Yeah, there's going to be a lot of farming here. Leo, he's just going to farm up through the wave. Cho'Gath, he's not going to want to really do too much until he's got some stacks under him. You cannot afford to die early on Cho'Gath. You need to get to 5 or 6 stacks. You need to have the ability to stay alive. That's one pressure point that RMU are going to have to try and exploit here, is make sure Mr. F gets shut down early and often.
In the bot lane, chances Clara still freezing this minion wave, trying to get all of that farm under his belt. But no real CS differentials have opened up just yet. Everyone's just bouncing those waves, farming up. The buddy system is still in full effect for both teams. Do have the Gragas heading into the bot side looking for that crab, and will be taking it. Also passed over a ward, so they have full knowledge of where UConn are right now.
Yeah, RMU have got really good knowledge here when it comes to the map. You can see the crab and the topside wards, now the lower side river wards, a couple of them have started to time out, but RMU made sure that there was nothing that UConn could do in any of these lanes to begin this game. We're in for a fairly extended laning phase here.
Yeah, and the question there is, who does it start benefiting? Because UConn will get tankier and tankier with this triple tank comp, whereas RMU, they want to be fighting earlier.
Here's a slight problem though, is that you've now got Hecarim in a 2v2 lane. And that's not exactly his strength. He can get harassed down from a distance. And, you know, look at this engage here out of UConn. They put damage onto Zig, force him to use his abilities to get some of that health back. And now they have to back away from the wave. There's no real way of RMU stepping up to UConn in this bottom lane for the next couple of minutes.
Over time, it's going to wear him down. But he does go for that chalice, or rather flask start with the pot. So he's going to be able to tank up a lot of that damage and that harass for a while, especially with Mini Bestia down there with him.
Interestingly enough, though, Urgot stacking a bit of a wave up in the top side, pushing into him, which makes the CS difference a little bit deceptive here. You can see 43 CS to 37, but both AD carries are about on course when it comes to farm between each other. But as we said, Tails stacking a wave means it looks like he's further behind than he actually is. But interestingly, Gnar has not even touched that top lane yet. He's kind of gone on the Kickis route, and he's going, hey, I'm going to play Gnar in the jungle.
Yeah, and yeah, he has not even been in a lane yet, but he is heading up there now, waiting for that wave to bounce from Tails, but he's freezing it quite well into that turret, so I'm not sure if there's going to be anything for Toys to go for, even if he arrives. Yeah, that wave is still pushing.
Yeah, that wave's going nowhere.
No.
At this point, Tails is just going to sit here and be happy to make sure he gets the farm here, and that actually is going to benefit RMU so much right now. You're not having your Urgot forced out in the beginning of the game. You're not kind of getting pushed in by a Sivir. Alistar's not able to engage on you, and Gnar is losing farm as well. So although he will get that natural tankiness of when he gets into his ultimate form, without items behind him, Mini Gnar is just going to be so susceptible to any kind of pressure. And Oberon, first Raptor's camp of the game, is a successful ward kill for him.
Yeah, and he'll just wait in that top bush because now the Gnar is completely blind, but he just threw out the Q. It didn't actually tag him, so he will still stick around.
Toys.
For something was up, but he didn't land the Q, so he assumes nothing's there, and it will just take a while for him to go back into this.
Oh, he's going in.
Jumps over the wall. He does come with the knock-up. Doesn't quite land it. Actually, unburrows just an inch away from it.
I was going to say, from the way Toys was playing that, he knew the right play was not to go all the way forward there. So he had it well read. And speaking of well read, Yukon, they turn their attention to the dragon as soon as they see over on topside. This is a really smart pickup here out from the Yukon lineup. First dragon of the game will go over to them. The question is now from RMU, what can they do to kind of get themselves a bit of an advantage from that dragon being taken? And right now they have no tower pressure really, so all they can do is counter jungle, and that's exactly what Oberon's doing.
Yeah, Yukon have really just played the reactive game because RMU, they were the ones who started up the lane swap. But that reactive playstyle has worked out great for them. And now Gnar's getting his farm. Now he's able to start farming up. Yes, the Hecarim has gone out of his bad matchup, but still, not sure if it's enough. There's a flash away from the Shockwave. So, a successful gank from Oberon, but he wants a little more from these early on.
Yeah, but that's enough for now. Getting the flash off Cho'Gath now means that if Cho tries to push out, he's going to get ganked. Cho right now only has, I think, one stack on his ultimate. In fact, he hasn't even really used it yet. It's on cooldown, but I wonder exactly what happened there. He seemed to have a full cooldown that as
yeah,
well.
Yeah, so full cooldown, so
didn't
it wasn't
actually
used to
kill
execute
a minion. So he doesn't have a stack. He would have used that on Leo, I guess, in that mid lane. That's curious. Because the race is on with Cho'Gath. You have to get that extra health, have to get that survivability in this early game, especially when you're in a farm matchup against Leo, because the likelihood of you killing an Orianna as Cho'Gath this early on is so slim.
Yeah, and even if Gragas comes in, yeah, he'll land the CC, but Leo, he stays so far back with that ball. Yeah, good luck. In the jungle, Jasmine still farming basically everything. Going into his blue buff now as well, taking that one away. I don't think he even needs to give it to Cho'Gath right now, because he's basically just farming as well. This is definitely a slower start to this game than we saw in the first best of three. Definitely more methodical, more thought out. T-Dollars, clearing out that ward,
aka
getting
T-Money.
That value. Yeah, all of that
he's
gold.
Getting the money, that's what he's getting.
He is indeed, Stress. There's the ward, Oberon. Fearing there could be a potential Jasmine in his jungle, but we'll be taking away this red buff as well. Meanwhile, in the bot lane, still farming up. We've now gone back to standard lanes away from the Australian lanes. Oh, there's the follow-up with T-Dollars, but E-Clara doesn't want to do too much right now.
Yeah,
just carry on farming.
So at this point, Tails, he has a CS lead. The thing they've got to be careful of here is, though, Sivir now with the BF sword has a fair amount of damage. Tails is still trying to stack a tier of the Goddess right now, doesn't have it as a mana mune. So RMU are playing this a touch greedy when it comes to how much they can harass. But look, as soon as they hit the Noxian Corrosive Charge, they land a Q, they get the damage down, and it forces Yukon away. So Yukon now have to respect RMU's trading, even though the itemization should mean, in theory, that Enchantress Clara should be able to lay
maybe
out a fair amount
in
of damage.
Theory,
in
perhaps
theory, should.
So T-Dollars again, getting that gold. Yeah, another 30 gold in the bank. Mid lane, still farming away. So what's the outlook as we get into mid game? Well, shut up, Pulse, because we're getting into a fight here in the bottom lane. Mini Bestia just get hit up.
Teleport
now coming down. That will be coming out from Gnar. He doesn't have any rage built up. So, yeah, Zig will be quite happy to go into the top lane and push it out.
A little bit of a misread there on the ultimate from Gragas. Tried to knock him backwards, couldn't quite land it. But at this point, when you use a teleport like that, you now have to get something from it. What do Yukon choose to do? They should look to get a little bit of control over this lower side, but Gnar's actually just going to recall away. Nothing could really be done in that bottom side of the match. So Yukon use a big summoner cooldown there for almost nothing from that. Now Zig has his teleport available. Dragon's due up in about 2 to 3 minutes here. So Zig is going to have a lot more impact on a potential dragon fight, and he's allowed himself to kind of get a big stack in front of him. So when he does decide to back, it's a bit problematic for Toys. He's going to end up with a full stack of minions shoved into him when he does choose to back.
Yeah, teleport advantage, and he'll be getting home guards pretty soon as well. Actually hasn't picked up boots yet, which is a little bit interesting, but it's been a slower start to the game. It just depends when he wants to really go for those fights. But home guards are pretty damn important on Hecarim top lane.
It is. This is kind of the difference, though, when you run Smite here. Some people still choose to go the home guards early, but this is going to allow Zig to build that Cinder Hulk earlier, make sure he dies less in any kind of potential engages. And honestly, with the kind of start that RMU have had right now, they are kind of up in most of their lanes. Oberon's trying to maybe get mid lane up even further here, as he is looking to gank Mr. F in that mid lane. He has changed his name, so we won't go that far on it. But Oberon finds his way in, doesn't really find anything there from Mr. F.
Yeah, going hard.
And he's
going
to cross back out.
And he'll be going into the upper side of the river and surfing back around and going for the pink ward. He's taking that one away, and he is now blind to the upper side of the river. Zig trying to get away from the house, being thrown down by Toys, and back into Mini Knot. So he'll be harassing him underneath turret.
Ooh.
That is getting the hyper proc off, so he'll be taking a trip back to base. But here's a teleport. He won't be using it to go back to lane, as Dragon is still on the horizon. We'll be spawning in 1 minute.
Yeah, 1 minute to Dragon. You look at the CS lead up in the top side, about 25 CS in favor of RMU. Mid lane is fairly even. Actually, wow, Zig uses the TP to get back to lane. RMU kind of maybe this. Okay, so RMU, it's either a bit of a misread on the Dragon timer because they didn't have the exact timer, or they just don't feel at this point that Yukon are going to be able to take a fight around Dragon. That's a very risky play here.
Yeah.
We'll see if it pays off for RMU, because it does allow RMU to control this top lane even more. You can see Zig is now kind of pushing it into the turret again.
So I don't think it's a misread, because they'd have to be off by like 5 minutes.
Yeah, exactly. So, that's what I mean. Is like it's either just a lapse right now, or RMU, it's a conscious decision to do it. And honestly, RMU are up in their lanes pretty much across the board. I'm interested to see exactly how many stacks Mr. F has right now, because that is going to be very important as we head to the first fight, as to how much he can survive through. But Yukon, they've got the timer on the Dragon. Looks like RMU are actually going to forgo this. You can see over on top side of the map is already pushing in. They're going to look to get a tower in response.
Yeah, they're going to go for that trade instead. So it'll be the second Dragon of the game going over to Yukon. Meanwhile, Tails has started to hit his item spike. Meanwhile, Aelia has done the same with the Athenians, with the Muramana, or the Manamune, which will be turning into a Muramana. But still, Yukon taking those early two dragons, they can start racing RMU for those objectives. We'll see how this will work out. Top lane still pushing in here. And finally, Toys will come back to find the wave.
He's going to be a little careful here. He doesn't have Mega Knot built up yet. He's not even close, so RMU can kind of just sit here. There's no real danger here of a Gnar ultimate hitting them or anything, because, okay, first turret goes down, but it is traded actually on the bottom side. So Yukon are keeping up very much so with RMU. It's a slight lead in favor of RMU on gold, but two dragons is exactly what Yukon need right now to keep RMU a little bit towards the back foot.
Yeah, trading blow for blow right now. As much as we've talked about how on paper, how much stronger the RMU look, well, Yukon so far is definitely not trailing behind all that much. Now pushing into the jungle for an aggressive invade onto this blue buff as well. Trying to get something away. Tails and Mini Bestia just harassing down Alistar. Maybe able to get one last Acid Hunter down to send them away, but still, there's the blue buff going over to Yukon. They're definitely putting down the pressure. Meanwhile, Oberon has gone into the top side of the map, taking away some of those camps. But definitely not pushing across all of the map with this fairly aggressive composition.
What I will say is, especially with a comp with so much engage, Yukon are not playing like the team that said, our strat is Ice Shout, and then Clara gets a pentakill. It doesn't really feel that way yet. We're 15 minutes in, and we haven't really had a big engage. We still haven't had first blood. That's getting up to almost unheard of territory. But look, Mr. F is so, so strong right now when it comes to his health.
Five
he
stats.
Is getting pretty big.
He is a very big Cho'Gath. RMU, the gloves are off, but with Yukon, the shirts are off. We'll see which one comes ahead.
Oh, dear. It was only a matter of time until we got to the shirtless references. But, you know, if you did catch that, BT, it's what Yukon are all about.
It is. And we'll see which one comes out on top. Oberon taking on the red buff. 400 health remaining. It goes down.
It does.
Meanwhile, a lot of items have been picked up. Talking about that, Cho'Gath has gone for the Rod of Ages now. So he'll be stacking that up along with his own stacks from his feast. Top lane has gone for that Sunfire Cape. So that says to me he's going to be just sitting in that lane, stopping Zig from pushing one-on-one against him, which makes sense because he's taking a smite. He's looking for that one-on-one challenge.
So I kind of feel like Yukon are in somewhat of a deceptive place right now when it comes to the Goldie. Shockwave in the middle lane
lands, and he'll be flashing away from the devastating charge out from Zig from the top lane. Came in very fast, but Mr. F will carry on farming away. 142 farm now, farming basically perfect.
Yeah, and that's going to be one of the biggest things coming into the first fight is whether Yukon can fight well enough to kind of overcome the CS difference and item difference between the two teams. Oberon is caught, though.
Yeah, the chain CC, now the teleport in from Toys, the flash over the wall, so they burn that summoner. Tails and Mini Bestia perhaps under attack, or perhaps not. They will return the Corrosive Charge and the Acid Hunters onto T-Dollars, and Toys will be taking away that tunnel as well. So far, there has not been a lot of tunnel network being set up. It's all in his own jungle, with a total of two tunnels. So yeah, he's not able to get a whole lot of removability from his ultimate.
I mean, in a game that's so controlled, it's actually fairly difficult. Oberon's going to go in. Toys is here, though, at the same time.
That's the rupture. We'll be coming across with the auto attacks as well, and the Feral Scream, and send him going back to base as well. Remember, Dragon is not up, so there's nothing to fight over down in the bottom river, but a lot of the vision has been set up around that area regardless.
Yeah, in a game that's so controlled right now, it's difficult for Oberon to get himself into these better positions for tunnels, so he's sticking with very defensive tunnels right now, which don't really help his map pressure, don't really help him get into lanes. It just allows him to kind of keep up here. You can see junglers right now are at 70 CS and 66 respectively, and that's actually a fair amount of CS right now this early. No kills on the board for either team yet. Both junglers are just farming it out.
Yeah, you even look at the jungles right now, it's completely barren from RMU and indeed UConn. Now a couple camps are respawning, but Mr. F has gone, has not gone back to base in a while. He's still sitting on that rod. Meanwhile, his counterpart, Leo, he's still on the Fiends, and the Cinderhawk has been picked up by the top lane as Toys did not go for the smite, so he will not have that one-on-one challenging smite, but he'll be going back into Mini-Gnar now. And what are we looking for this mid-game? Because going back to Champion Select, we're talking about RMU and how they want to be fighting. They want to be fighting earlier while Yukon, they're tanks. They want to just keep on farming.
Yeah, at this point, RMU kind of have to fight over the next dragon, because when you give a team comp that has Sivir in it, the third dragon, you give them extra mobility. You give them even more on top of that when Sivir pops their ultimate. So this is a dragon that RMU basically have to fight, but I don't think they'll be too unhappy to fight, depending on how much gold they're sitting on. They are ahead in the lanes, but if they don't convert that into an item difference between the two teams, it's not going to show itself until after the fight. And Yukon could potentially still hold on. Very importantly, Mr. F just picked up a needlessly large rod as well, so that's going to give him a big spike of damage landing those ruptures, silencing in the fight as well. So it's all on RMU to kind of make sure they've got vision control, which they do already. That's step one. Now they have to make sure they take the right fight against Yukon and then get the dragon.
Well, they're looking for the setup. They have the vision. They have Zig at base with his teleport. They have his home guards as well. And another 15 seconds. So we need this to be a very good disengage by Clara.
RMU need to bait Yukon down the ramp. However, Yukon have swept the ward on top, so now there's no chance of a TP directly behind them. But there's one in the river bush.
Hecarim could come in. He's coming in with the teleport. He's coming in from right behind. How much damage can they deal before he goes for this first fight? He comes in from the back lines, jumps right onto Clara. There's no peel for him. Great shockwave onto three players. Oberon as well gets the knockup and the turnaround with the onslaught of shadows. There's first blood going over to that Hecarim. Now, Mr. M will be going down. This is very quickly turning into a bloodbath and a whitewash. Jasmine will have to flash over the wall. Someone is burned left and right. Another death-tasting charge onto T-Dollars. He goes down. All those wards in the early game did not help him there. 3-0. RMU come out victorious.
Hecarim engages a dragon by the book. Bait them in, teleport behind them, take the fight. It looked a little bit risky. Mini Bestia dropped low to begin the fight, but the timing was just about right for Zig. Gets on top. They got a three-person shockwave this early on. Orianna doesn't have a massive amount of damage to really provide that big instant chunk for the 3,000 ELO shockwave, but RMU doing exactly what they need to do. They get their first dragon of the game. Now they get a tower on top of it as well. RMU have the outer ring down.
Yeah, and that was still a good shockwave because it completely split up Yukon. Clara was completely by himself while there was a Hecarim on his face and it was no one to peel for him. Even though he has this huge front line, the peel from Alistar, and it still wasn't enough. This is going to become a serious problem if Yukon cannot teamfight correctly against RMU, because they had all the tools. They were pretty much equal with RMU. Now they're not.
The timing from RMU was right, though. That's the thing that we need to focus on, is Yukon couldn't sit around because RMU were just going to start the dragon. If you're not there to take the dragon, as we can see, look at RMU already zoning down the river. Here's the teleport coming in. Gnar doesn't even have Rage Bar built up and gets exhausted to begin the fight. There's the shockwave you were talking about there. So RMU, right now, they've split up so well. Oberon with the knockups as well. There's almost nothing right now that Yukon could have done in this situation instead of just give RMU the dragon. That was their two options. It was take the fight and hope there's no ward right where we want to fight, or we give them the dragon.
Yeah, honestly, that was just textbook. They had the setup, they set up the wards, they had a place for Zig to come in with the teleport, they timed the teleport as well. It was just perfectly done and perfectly executed by RMU, and so many times we see these types of compositions and the question is, can they execute it well? In this case, Stress, yes they can. Yeah. They can do it very well, and Yukon, they'll need to find a way around that.
It was textbook, but it didn't cost as much as textbooks normally do. However, Leo nearly managed to get caught out in the mid lane. Did have many Bestia around though, and Leo just picked up a needlessly large rod of his own there, so he's going to get a big spike of extra damage himself. Again though, RMU were up in the lanes by quite a margin. Mid lane was even when it came to CS. Now there's a lead in favor of Leo. It's only a small one, but add on the kill and two assists to that, and an Orianna that is going to scale further and further. This is a less explosive game than we were expecting, but RMU are in full control.
Honestly, this is the type of game I was expecting from RMU, because they are that team who have all of that backing. They just come into the game calculated, and that's what we're seeing. And we're seeing Yukon struggling to adapt to that calculated playstyle where they can't just scream and go for pentacles.
I liked the early game from Yukon. They actually played it pretty well. They didn't fall too far behind either. So Yukon are certainly fighting here against RMU, and they're showing that they have enough left here. The question is, can they figure out what RMU's next play is before RMU make it and then react to them in turn? Toys is going to be such a big part of this. If he can get Mega Gnar, if he can get a good ultimate, that's how Yukon are going to be able to get themselves back into this game. It's just under a 6,000 gold lead right now in favor of RMU, which is a big lead, but it's not insurmountable.
No, it is not, but that is the big problem for them, because Gnar is so difficult to control with the Gnar bar nowadays. It will be difficult for them to get in. Let's take a look at the gold here in the top lane. Such a big difference. 8,800 up against 5,000, 3,000 gold differential in the top lane alone. And you can see that represented live as we see Zig take on Toys, now going into his Mega Gnar, and he'll just back away from the very angry Gnar.
Zig's just got to wait this out. It's only a couple of seconds that Toys is going to be able to...
Got it.
I say wait it out, but if he's got the rest of his team heading down through the jungle, if he can bait Toys into a fight right as Mini Gnar pops, he's got his ultimate available if he chooses.
He might just take one on one. He does have the Onslaught of the Shadow, still has the Smite as well. The rest of the team is closing in from the top side. Mini Bestia is there. T-Dollars, though, with the support, is still hanging around the area, but against this three-man squad, I'm not sure if he can do too much about it. Clara now heading into the bot lane, as is Jasmine, so need to make sure that RMU do not overextend here. But still, they are setting up, they are getting the aggressive vision down into the opposing jungle, and they are taking everything with that one pop of the Raptors.
The only thing that RMU haven't done yet is push the top lane in as well. They obviously, the outer tower is not there for Yukon, so Zig's going to go shove that in, make sure they have full map control. Dragon up in 1 minute 20. This is a good setup here by Zig. What you want to do here, set up a slow push wave. It means in about a minute's time, when the dragon spawns, that's exactly when you can make it push. But I don't think you can actually slow push this because of how far it had pushed up the lane. Yeah. A couple of seconds earlier, Zig might have been able to do it, but he's going to have to shove it fully in for now and then look to teleport in to the dragon fight. But it could be repeat performance. Look at how many wards RMU have in the lower jungle of Yukon.
Yeah, sprinkled all over. Zig just trying to clear out the back line of minions. Meanwhile, Toys is there to meet him, so he'll be able to push away that wave. But now in the one-on-one once again, and that's a Zig who has basically his core item set right now, the Cinderhulk, the Triforce, and the Home Guards with the Ninja Tabby. So he's in really good shape. shape for this next fight that could open up in around 35 seconds. He has a teleport, Toys has a teleport, and this is pretty much as even a playing field as you're going to get, as every single summoner is up.
Problem is, though, Mega Gnar just expired for Toys, so he's got to go through that cooldown period now and look to get himself over. Yeah. At the best, Gnar players will build their Rage Bar and then teleport into a fight. We'll see whether Toys can line that up, but look at the damage already that Tails has. Jasmine's been caught in. Can he stay alive?
Well, T-Dollars is trying to zone away, but now here comes the pincer movement out from Zig, coming in with the teleport. He'll be actually dashing away. Jasmine managed to disrupt him, but they found Toys with the position reverser. He'll be going down, but Leo has been caught out on Flawless Shadows onto three players from UConn, and this is just all going downhill from here. There's the triple kill for Leo as well. Another kill, the double kill for Zig. A 5-0 sweep, and they could do whatever they want with the map.
The full house from RMU, triple kill over double kill, and they turn their attention to the Baron. It looked potentially like UConn had a better setup this time. They didn't get baited down the ramp, backed away. Unfortunately, though, Zig comes in, manages to find himself an Onslaught of Shadows. Even Leo's shockwave whiffed in that, and with that, RMU still win that fight. They have such a big lead right now, and they are going to take a Baron on top of that.
That was so clean, and look at the health bars from RMU as well. The only person who took damage really was Mini Bestia. The rest of the team was pretty much at 100%, and they completely 100-0%ed UConn. Such an impressive fight from them. They've gone back to base, they picked up so many items. Look at the power spikes right now, and they'll go for Dragon as well, in the knowledge that UConn, they just can't contest it.
And meanwhile, Tails, with his license to assist a 007, was taking mid tower as well. Now he turns his attention onto the Dragon. RMU, they will take their second Dragon of the game. Those two that they gave to UConn early have not made an effect right now. RMU are in absolute dominant control.
Incredibly well thought out. Don't need the first two Dragons. We'll just trade objectives for them instead in forms of turret. We'll farm. We'll get to the point where we can fight. We'll get the timings down and we'll go for the fight then. And it's worked out fantastically. With that 10,000 gold lead right now, just a little bit over, RMU have commanding control over this game up against UConn. And look at all the kill, look at the kill distribution as well. But either way, we're going to take another look at that last team fight.
So here's the setup. T-Dollars, aka half health at this point. I'm going to keep making that joke until I really run it dry. Here comes Zig into the fight. Gets his home guard shut down. That's pretty key. It drops his damage fairly significantly on the first hit, but he's so far ahead right now, he doesn't need that extra damage. By this point, RMU have got just the surround of UConn, and UConn, it's a pretty easy cleanup there from RMU at that point. But UConn right now, they can't really afford to go for the next Dragon. They cannot afford to contest it. They have to concede it and just try and tuck in and hope RMU kind of do the dive that UBC did in the last game. if you guys caught that one, UBC going all the way into the base. But RMU right now, they're very reserved in this game. They have a big lead, but they're not trying to overextend. All they're going to do is push their waves in. They're 1-3-1-ing right now, and they're getting turrets from it.
Yeah, just pushing in every single lane, going for the 1-3-1 with the 3 at the top lane, so the 3-1-1 is Tails in the mid lane just pushing away. They'll be taking all of these inner turrets.
And this is something they can do because you look at their vision control as well. Not only have they got Baron, which allows them to do it just naturally better, they can just move between lanes as well because they have full control of the vision when it comes to knowing UConn have to be in their base. Well, there's no way they're not.
We're getting to a breaking point here. Stress Tails will be coming in with the reverser onto Jasmine, the 2v2 in the bottom lane. Two massive tanks up against the damage and follow through from Zig. There's the Onslaught of Shadows. Now it will be Clara coming into this one, looking for the damage onto Zig, but they've already taken down one of his allies. Mr. F comes in from the mid lane. They're closing in. The rest of the team from RMU is coming in from the mid lane. Clara is extremely low. Tails in this 1-3 has been exhausted as well. There comes the shockwave, and they keep him alive. He'll just carry on battling down onto T-Dollars. There down goes Jasmine as well, trying to take out Mr. F, and everyone's going to die. Clara is the only one surviving, and he's outside of his own base. This is RMU's base now.
Zig even managed to survive from that. RMU have not looked out of form at all in this game, and they're going to look to end.
Yeah, and RMU 12-0 in this game. Utter dominance. 9-2 in the towers. Take down the Nexus turrets as well, and onto the Nexus. RMU in this first game of this best of three. Take it to UConn and take the first game.
A really solid performance out of RMU. Everything from minute one looked planned. Everything looked in their control. Not even a kill dropped to UConn. That's a pretty incredible performance when you look at it. It's difficult to beat a team that, you know, comprehensively, but then not to die once doing it. Very rarely do you get that.
It's like better Copenhagen Wolves, where you script out the early game, but then everything after that's still scripted, and then you finish it out.
I mean, you can see the effect the coaching staff has. Yeah. It's one thing that we've seen even in the LCS this year, this season. The effect that bringing in coaches just to help you plan matchups, plan picks and bans, it's just such a good factor here. And now, it's even going to help them now, between games, is to say, hey, look, we just got to do the same again. Keep it in check, don't get too overconfident. On the other side of things, UConn right now, they know what they basically have to do for this game, and is make sure they just go all out on RMU. They were controlled, maybe let it a little bit loose.
Yeah, I mean, like, the question was, they've done so well up until this point. Of course, they're in the finals right now, the top four. And will they just be able to keep on going with that, with how it's gone before, because they didn't need that coaching staff behind them, this big support. But now they're going up against that. Which one wins out? Well, currently RMU are leading the race in this best of three, and now one game away from being eliminated from the NACC and taking that spot behind the finals. It's not what they want right now.
No, it is certainly not what they want right now.
No, it is not. Anyway, we're going to shoot it over to Dash and the rest of the crew to break down that game.
Thank you, gentlemen. That was an interesting game because it was so close until 20 minutes.
Yeah.
And then RMU just blew it open. Just entirely blew the game wide open, 20 minutes without a kill. And then they finish 12-0, no deaths, and end the game in the next 10 minutes. So it shows what they can do when they have that lead. This is a team that is practiced. And as the guys on the desk mentioned, their coaching staff has prepared them to close games out.
Yeah, it was exciting, honestly. I kind of had my, I was holding my breath there for his zig at the end. I was like, is he going to die? He just runs circles around the Nexus. No, it was awesome. Honestly, methodical play, right? We were talking about it here in the desk. We were like, oh, this is actually a little bit closer than we thought, right? Like, and then up until that moment, they won the fight. They flipped the switch. Zig teleported in, beelined over to Sivir. Not a single person tried to stop him, right? After that, there was no stopping them. They snowballed pretty massively.
And you can see the fight going down right now. The Hecarim TP on the backline is the most important part. Enchantress Clara able to spell shield, but it's not enough. This Hecarim is just too strong. They're able to push through. Oberon barely makes it out. A beautiful dark passage for Mini Bestia. And now it's just easy for Tails and Leo to clean this one up. And Zig hasn't even been touched. So much power on this RMU lineup.
And that's what was proven so much by this game, the fact that RMU is putting so many resources into getting Signature a good early start. Put him on a carry champion and then put him in a position to carry with that, right? Hecarim has a notoriously rough laning phase against certain champions, Gnar being one of them.
Exactly.
If you're ranged, you can harass an insane amount. So they say, you know what? We're going to throw a lane swap in. We'll get you an ADCS lead. And then we'll have you TP into this fight and pick up a few kills, but not until 20 minutes in. Until that point, they're like, here, have a couple dragons. They even gave up the first turret of the game. So in their lane swap, they were willing to give up everything just to secure an early lead for a single player on their team.
And around the 15-minute mark, I was concerned. I've seen RMU play so much, and this was unlike them to give up so many early objectives. I thought for a moment that they might be shaken. They might not have the confidence in their own play coming into these games, but it was all just calculated. It was planned out. They knew when they were strong, and they executed in that dragon fight and then for the rest of the game.
Well, but I would agree with you, too, though, that there may have been a little bit too much reservation, because I do feel that when you pull a lane swap like that, you're right to give up those dragons, as your AD carry is not on the strong side for the first couple of them. But when you do send your jungler top in order to put pressure on the top lane and give up those dragons, you have to push that turret down. You absolutely need. They could have created that gold lead much earlier in the game. They didn't have to wait till 20 minutes to get there.
Yeah, no, you are exactly right. Time and time again with the one you were bringing up, right? They were shoving top, they had kind of a gank. You immediately see UConn go for the dragon. Stick around, right? Get damage on that tower. And then eventually once they swapped Urgot back into the bot lane, they also kind of didn't really do anything with it. They didn't really fight. You were like, okay, now you have a massive lead on this guy. And what is that? So it was less about setting Urgot up for success or setting the Hecarim up for success and more about denying toys. This is their substitute mid laner, right? He had like 7 farm and he I think it was level 3, about 5 minutes into the game. That is a massive deficit. And if he hasn't been playing with the team very long, he can be in a situation where that is really hard for him to come back from.
And it's definitely going to be difficult to communicate with this team as a whole. Avanti, the former top laner, was known as the shot caller. He was the guy who helped keep the team grounded in those situations, helped keep level heads. And while it does appear that they've adapted to that, you got to know that there's a ton of pressure on Toys to fill those shoes.
Yeah, I do briefly want to mention UConn's comp, though. I actually did like it quite a lot. It is a low damage comp, which is, I think, why I was a little worried about the early game reservation, right? Because if that one fight doesn't go very well for them, Cho'Gath, Gragas, these characters kind of just beat you down with their base damages and make it really hard for you to climb back into it. But I think they drafted well, and I think they played well. They had a really good start, but once the fight started beginning, it wasn't just the massive gold leads. You saw those fights in the base. They just mechanically outplayed them. They
yes.
dodged death for so long, no amount of gold is going to make you invincible. Great mechanics will.
Well, and that's the scary thing for UConn, because I do agree, they actually played into the lane swap pretty well, right? Mm-hmm. At the very beginning, they seemed a little thrown off by the Cloud9 Lemon Nation level 1 invade on Mini Bestia with the Thresh, which is a fantastic way of putting people on, you know, off kilter, you know, having to abandon the Gromp, find CS elsewhere. But as you mentioned, Gnar down 4 CS to 30, you know, at some point. But beyond that, their duo lane kept up in farm. Their mid laner Cho'Gath scaled well, avoided ganks, used his flash when needed, but had the proper vision to still be aggressive and farm up in lane after blowing flash. They did play that first 20 minutes very well, but things did fall apart in that dragon fight. And is that, I guess what it comes to is that a question of, you know what, they need to recognize where those power spikes are and say, that's a fight we don't want to take. Give up that dragon because we're still not giving up gold. After that fight, it was a 5K gold lead. It was Dragon, 3 kills, 2 towers.
Yeah.
It was 5K gold. It went from no gold lead to 5K gold lead. Give up the dragon. It's the second dragon. Who cares? Give it up. Stick into the game for longer. You have Cho'Gath, Sivir. You'll be able to eat away at those at the Hecarim later in the game. He does fall off a bit.
Yeah.
And I really just want to see better map movement in the mid game when they have that early advantage, if they can get it again from University of Connecticut, just because, like we said, they got the tower at about the same time RMU did on top of those two dragons, and while that 6% AD and AP are not huge, it is an advantage and they can force it. They have a team to do so. They have the Gragas, they have the Cho'Gath, they have the Sivir. If anyone is out of position, they can catch them instantly. On the Hunt is such a powerful tool.
That's a really good point. Given that they had two dragons early in that lane swap, RMU gave up two dragons. I would have loved to have seen UConn utilize that second dragon buff, which is enhanced turret tower destruction, to rotate around the map. Because if RMU was happy to stall the game out and continue building their lead, UConn can respond then by saying, fine, if you want to do that, we'll let Hecarim push while we five-man push mid, take a turret. And then we'll go five-man push bottom, take a turret. Let's accelerate the game. Right? And avoid the team fights, play the pushing game. You have the mobility of Sivir, you can get out of fights if you don't want them.
Yeah, definitely. I think UConn was honestly a little surprised that they were controlling and hanging in there as well as they were. And so they were like, well, two dragons up. We haven't fought them yet. We don't honestly know how strong they're going to be. Gnar's ult is pretty good. Let's run it in and let's see if we can get that third dragon. Because once we're in there, we can start trading off every dragon after that for more objectives. I'm with you. They probably shouldn't have fought there. What I'd like to see, though, in this next game, compositionally, I would like to see a little, I don't want to say something more risky, but something more explosive from UConn. Something that can really make a larger impact and can kind of slingshot them from a behind position. That said, the way RMU played this, we were saying a little too cautious, I wouldn't be surprised if they don't go for the throat this game.
Absolutely. Well, I think, too, though, you know, UConn should come away with some confidence after that game. Although it was a 30-minute loss, up until that 20-minute mark, they played well. Both of these teams in the feature leading up into the match expressed some confidence. And, you know, we're going to hear from the teams right now in that they both have pretty strong feelings about the relative strengths of each region.
This year we're bringing a lot of things different to the table. We actually practiced a bit this year. We've been working out physically in order to make sure that we are able to compete at the top of our game. I'm most excited about being able to play on the big stage, being able to really show off what we've got. East Coast is constantly underestimated, so I'm ready to make a difference, make an impact, show the other teams what we're made of.
Coaches and infrastructure at RMU, and we have dedicated setups for practice and everything, so we haven't been playing too many ranked games lately, so there isn't much scouting that our opponents can do. We didn't really want to show any strategies or anything past a certain point. Some other teams consider that to be fear. However they interpret it is up to them. It doesn't really matter to us.
UConn has just raw talent going for them. You know, we're really bold, we're confident. Collection of strong boys, whereas RMU, even with a psychologist helping them out, they're just going to choke once they get on stage. They can't handle it.
I know Jasmine33 posted a nice comment on the NACC Facebook page that was something like, we're just a speed bump on the way to finals for them. If you drive too fast over a speed bump, your car gets wrecked, so...
UBC was making fun of one of the quotes I made earlier about how RMU is just going to be a speed bump on the way to first place. But, you know, I'm fine with having a couple more speed bumps. We can run over UBC, we can run over Texas. I just really hope that RMU actually shows up this time. We're ready to ride right over them.
I absolutely love that point about driving over a speed bump too quickly can wreck your car, and that is a danger here for UConn coming in with a little bit too much confidence and hubris and overlooking their opponent. You know, on the flip side, though, they talk about wanting to make an impact and show the rest of the nation that the East is here to play with the big dogs. Well, there's no better way to do it than to come out with a victory here against RMU.
Yeah, and even if they can't pull out a victory, right, altering a little bit of their game plan from the first game and having just a fantastic showing in game two can really kind of elevate what people think of their region, what people think of them as a team, right? If you think about game two of the previous series, that one was honestly over faster than this one was, right? So for the team, people have kind of been saying RMU's the boogeyman, RMU's the person they're going to come through with their big esports money and crush our little faces in. First 20 minutes of that game had a completely different story to it.
Well, definitely. And the thing I really want to see from University of Connecticut is a different set of picks. I know we talked about how we kind of like this comp. It may have been low damage, but it had a lot of options. I want to see a little bit more comfort picks for both of these teams. I want to see Jasmine on that Rek'Sai if he can secure it for himself. I want to see Mr. F in that mid lane on his Ahri. That's the champion he played most in the qualifiers for this tournament and was really dominant on it, consistent on those charms in the mid to late game, and that was such an important part for these teams' engages.
Yeah, it's interesting that Gragas was actually the first pick, 3 games now in a row.
Yeah.
Right? The moment he locked it in, I was like, hey, I guess he plays Gragas, right? But Rek'Sai has also been fantastic for the winning teams here, so being able to take that one away could be really strong.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. I would like to see a change up in picks here for UConn. I want them to trend more aggressive, so the Ahri would be fantastic. I actually think Gragas is still fine. Rek'Sai, too. Rek'Sai is a little bit more aggressive. Gragas can still make plays in the early game, but I want them to assess what RMU's strategy was there, which was that let's play slow and we'll beat them late with organized team fights. UConn, accelerate the game. Get them into a position where they're uncomfortable and they're having to react to you.
Yeah. That said, I kind of wonder if RMU wasn't just putting their feelers out, right? A lot of pressure coming into this game. They have one game under their belt. They can breathe easy. This is where we might see Leo bust out some of his more risky picks, right? Zig already top lane dominance, right? I think it was 23 minutes, had over 3,000 gold over his opponent, right? Like, Zig is going to do fine on almost any character that he gets. But if everyone else can say, let's not give them as much breathing room this time, I think we can see that Bob Chin Cassidy level snowball take place in this game, and they can close that out and feel really confident going into tomorrow.
All right. Well, I mean, RMU showing us clear, methodical play. Perfect game there, not giving up a single kill. UConn here definitely have an uphill battle ahead of them. We're going to toss it back over.